welcome to Coastlands Community Church. We are situated in Tableview, Cape Town, led by Pastors Xavier and Heather Adrianser. We are a church family that is committed to love, accept, and forgive. Our goal is to reach out, allow the Holy Spirit to bring restoration, and release people into their God-given purpose. May God bless you as we worship and hear God's word together.
Morning, everybody. Welcome to church in this nice, cold, rainy morning. We have a quick message from our pastor, and then we'll get going this morning.
Good morning, Coastlands. Greetings from Uganda. What a privilege it is to be with Pastor Sean and Shina. This is their church building in the background, and I get to share the word this morning at their church and trust God to do amazing things. And also, as we pray for you this morning, we pray that God will do an amazing work in Cape Town. Behind me too is one of the first homes that they're establishing that will reach out to young children that are disadvantaged, and some are orphaned, and they're believing God to do amazing things. Let me just give you a quick snapshot of what God is doing. This is the land behind them. You have some vegetable gardens, and you have various projects that are taking place. And this morning, we're so excited to be here. So we trust God is going to do amazing things in both places. God bless you. We love you, and we're looking forward to seeing you again.
Isn't that just awesome? For those of you that don't know, Sean used to be part of our church here in Cape Town, and he used to serve with Zave in Cape Town. And he felt that God called him to Uganda a couple of years ago to start up a church. And if you look at what's happened in all those buildings in the background, that started off from scratch, absolute scratch. So if you know the testimony of Sean and where he comes from, and at one stage of his life he was on the streets, it's just so awesome to see that coming out of what God's planned for someone's life. So let's open this morning as we go into worship. I just want to read out of Psalms 95, verse 1 to 7. It says, "Come and let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come to Him with thanksgiving. Let us sing psalms of praise to Him. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. He holds in His hands the depths of the earth, and in the mightiest of mountains. The seas belong to Him, for He made it. His hands form the dry land too. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker, for He is our God. We are the people that He watches over, and the flock under His care." So let's open in prayer this morning. Father God, we come before You as Your church and as Your people. And Father, I pray this morning as we enter into Your gates, Lord Father, that You would strip away the things and the worries and the troubles of this week that have held us back from You, Father. We ask You this morning just to be with us in this place. May Your presence resonate in this place as we worship You this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand as we worship God.
I've traded my sorrows. I've traded my shame. I'm laying them down for joy of the Lord. I've traded my sickness. I've traded my pain. I'm laying them down for joy of the Lord. I've traded my sorrows. joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for joy of the Lord. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. But not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, and His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes with the morning. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Amen. And we say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Amen. I'm pressed, but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, and His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes with the morning. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. And we say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, yes, Lord, amen. Propane that I am yours.
you've done for me. I lift up my hands for all to see. You're the only one who brings me to my knees to share His love across the earth, the beauty of Your holy word. So I kneel before You, God. I lift my hands 'cause You set me free. So I shout out Your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am Yours. I am Yours. And all that I am, I place it to Your loving hands. And I am Yours. I am Yours. The One, the Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the One, the Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. So I shout out Your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am Yours. I am Yours. And all that I am, I place into Your loving hands. And I am Yours. I am Yours. So I shout out Your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am Yours. I am Yours. Wide open to the One, the Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God.
that I am yours. I am yours. And all that I am, I'll place into your loving hands, and I am yours. I am yours. So I shout out your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am yours. Place into your loving hands, and I am yours. I am yours. Unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, until all my fears have gone. I'm no longer a slave. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Thank you. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love. You rescue me and I will stand and sing. I am a child of God.
Oh,
Father God, we thank you that you're a God that just never fails, Lord Father. We thank you, Father, that you're a God that I'm reminded of when David said, "Who am I that you are mindful of me, Lord Jesus?" And it's with that same heart that, Father, we know that every single one of us has a need in our life. Every single one of us has something that we're counting on you to come through for us, Lord Jesus. And Father, I pray whatever that thing might be in every single person's life, Lord, that you would just meet us. The blood of the Lamb would be over that thing. The hedge of protection would cover us. And Lord, that we can stand faithful knowing that you, our Father, our God, our Shepherd, our Carer, our Protector, you've got this. So, Father, we thank you that you we know you, that we can bring these things before you, Lord Jesus. And we also thank you, Father, that we know that you will give us the desires and the needs of our hearts because you love us so much, Lord Father God. Lord, I think about Dalmain this morning. Zave let me know this morning that she passed away of cancer and yesterday. And, Lord, we just lift her up and we lift up Nicholas, Lord Father God, her son. And we pray for them as a family, Lord Father God. And we pray for Nicholas as he struggles to just comprehend what's happened to his mom, Lord Father God. But Father, we know that she's with you. And we know that you have her and you're holding her close to your breast, Lord Father God. And we thank you for that. And we pray over Nicholas's life. We pray that you would just be with him, that you would comfort him, Lord. And you just give him peace that surpasses all understanding through your Spirit, Lord Jesus. And Father, as we prepare for your word this morning, we want to thank you and pray over Keith as he brings the message this morning. That thank you for his heart. Thank you for him making himself available to deliver a message to your people, Lord Father God. And we pray, Father, that there would be boldness and peace as he brings your word this morning. And we pray, Father, that you'd use him as a vessel to speak to your church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can we take up the tithes and offerings this morning as we prepare for the message? And can the kids also get ready for Children's Church? And before we start, I've been asked just to mention that you must not forget about the Poiki Course competition. Please let Hanalee know if you're entering the Poiki Course competition. Enjoy the word this morning.
Was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through. I'm gonna make it through. Cause I'm standing strong on you. I'm gonna make it through. Cause my house is built on you.
Welcome to everybody. Oh, here we go. And welcome to everybody online. I just trust that the Lord will speak to us this morning and touch every heart. And maybe I've got an anointing on me. And it's bad because I'll cry. So excuse me. This message that I'm bringing, I'm not trying to put you under, what would you call it, condemnation or anything like that. It's just a message to, and the title of the message is Consider Your Ways, or Evaluate Your Position, Where You're Going, Your Path, Evaluate Your Path. And that's what the message is about. And we're going to start with that. They've gone. We're going to turn to, and the first part of the message is actually to establish who you believe is in charge. Okay? It's a challenge to you. Who do you believe is in charge of everything? And I'm glad what Craig brought this morning is because, God is in charge. And so we're just going to read this and then establish that so that you have no doubt as to who's in charge. So we're going to turn to Deuteronomy 32. It says, I see now that I myself am he. There is no God besides me. I put to death, I bring to life. So, you know, when you read through the Bible, you'll get through the prophets and there'll be stuff there. And then all of a sudden, the word of the Lord comes out clearly. And you know that it's God speaking to you, not... It's not the prophet anymore, it's God. And so, as I've been going through the Bible, this is not to brag, I've been through this Bible, so I'm going through it the third time this year, because I'm not used to the NIV. You know, I'm used to the St. King James Bible, and I'm trying to sort of get a hold on the Bible. So that's why I've been going through it, but... As I've been going through, these are the words that jumped out at me. It says, you see now that I myself am he. There is no God besides me. I put to death, I bring to life. I have wounded and I will heal. And no one can deliver out of my hand. He says, I lift my hand to heaven and declare, as surely as I live forever, when I sharpen my flashing sword, and my hand grasps it in judgment. I will take vengeance on my adversaries and repay those who hate me. Now, this is God speaking. And we're going to go to the next one. It's in Hannah. You know, this word came after Moses was actually making the people sing a song. He made them sing a song. And then this word comes after the song. And when Hannah brought Samuel to Eli, remember, she also speaks a word, like a prophetic word out. And that's the next word that we're going to have a look at. This is 1 Samuel 2. And she says, the Lord brings to death and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and raises up. The Lord sends poverty and wealth. He humbles and exalts, and he exalts. He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes and has them inherit the throne of honor. For the foundation of the earth are the Lord's. Upon them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his saints, but the wicked will be silenced in darkness. It is not by strength that one prevails. Okay, so... That's the word that she brings, and it's just to establish who's in charge. Because, you know, things happen in your life, and you're not sure, is it from God, is it from Satan, or whatever. Whatever comes to you has got to go through him. He won't allow it if it's not supposed to touch you. Okay? So he's in charge. And then the last one of these kind of scriptures that I want to speak about was... It's during the second year of Darius, when it was just after Ezra started building the temple, and then they were stopped building the temple. So Haggai, the prophet, he comes along and he tries to stir them up to start again, to build the temple. So it says in Haggai 1 verse 6, it says, you have planted much. Now, you know, I'm saying, consider your ways, evaluate your paths. Where are you today and what's happening in your life? And he says, you have planted much, but have harvested little. You eat, but never have enough. You drink, but you never have your full. You put on clothes, but you are not warm. You earn wages, only to put them in a purse with holes in it. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. So consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring down timber and build the house so that I may take pleasure in it and be honored, says the Lord. You expected much, but see, it turned out to be little. What you brought home, I blew away. Why, declares the Lord Almighty? Because of my house, which remains a ruin, while each of you is busy with his own house. Now, obviously, this is literal. The scripture is literal, so don't get me wrong. I'm going to use a bit of, poetic license, and I'm going to change the scripture to say, your spiritual house and your physical man, okay? So we're kind of looking at what state is your physical life in and what state is your spiritual life in. And that's why we say consider your ways. So we're going to get back to that just now because we're going to have a look at some of those scriptures. Those were sent to rebuild, stop building, as I mentioned now. And he says, is this the time for you to be living in your paneled houses? And I think it's in Haggai 1 verse 4 again, but I'll just read it. In your paneled houses while the house remains in ruin. And that, of course, I've mentioned to you already, is a literal thing. Okay, we've done that. So now the question is, are we pampering our physical body at the cost of our spiritual body? Okay, so you know, just think about your life and how you spend your time. Is it more pampering your physical body or is it actually working on your spiritual body? We're going to look at the exodus of the people of Israel. We sang a song where the water, you know, we're talking about the water, you opened up the water first and you went through, etc. And I'm going to speak a bit about Exodus, but only, it's not going to be the whole 40 years, it's only the first 3 days, so don't get too worried about it. when we get into this, it says, in Exodus, you know, the Lord is dealing with his people Israel, and he's also dealing with the Egyptians, okay? And we're going to look at this, how this is, you know, we can apply this to our own lives today. Then in Exodus 6 verse 5, it says, verse 3. Exodus 6 verse 5. Six verse five. Yeah. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians are enslaving, and I have remembered my covenant with them. And in Exodus 3 verse 7, the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I've come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of Israelite has reached me, and I've seen the way that the Egyptians are oppressing them. And what I'd just like to bring out is that the Lord sees everything that you and I are going through. And he's concerned about our groanings. You know, my wife sometimes wakes me up when she's groaning. So I was thinking of, you know, sometimes Paul speaks about speaking in tongues, you know, with groanings that cannot be uttered. So when she wakes me up, I think, oh, she's probably, you know, speaking in tongues, groaning, etc. So, but I mean, God knows exactly what each one of us is going through, and He's concerned about it. Just remember that God loves each and every one of us. He's working in our lives, and He's trying to get us to actually consider our ways, see where we are, so that we can make some changes in our lives. I heard a pastor once. I was listening to a talk show, and the pastor was being questioned, and he made this statement. He said, all Christians, that's all of us, we're either in Egypt or we're in the wilderness, one of the two. And I started thinking about that, but when I heard that, another scripture kind of jumped up at me, and it was one that I read in Exodus 6, verse 3. So we'll get to it just now. He says, I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty. But by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself known to them. Now, in the King James, which I'm used to, it says, by my name, Jehovah, I have not made known to them. And when I started thinking about that, as Christians, we maybe get to know God as the Almighty God, but we never get to know Him in all His aspects and His abilities in our, and what He can do in our lives. And that word, I think in this NIV, it also mentions Yahweh. You know the word Yahweh or Jehovah? And that word means, it's like the basis of He's ever present, He's ever faithful, and He's ever caring. That's the God that we serve. Okay, so we're going to just have a look a little bit later on all the names of the Lord. But now, before we look at this wilderness experience, we're going to look at Exodus 14, verse 32. I mean, sorry, 38. It's how the Lord saved Israel. Okay? Now, we know that when they left Egypt, they marched for a couple of days before they got to the Red Sea. Okay? So it's a couple of days, and it says there in Exodus 6, verse 3, I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob as... No, got the wrong one. Sorry. Exodus 14, verse 38. 38. Okay, maybe that's the right one. It says, they went through the water, because the wind blew all night long, and the sea sort of opened up, and then a wall on each side of them, and the cloud was behind them, so the Egyptians couldn't get them, and there was a light in front of them, and so they went through the Red Sea, and then afterwards, the Lord just closed up and drowned them all. Okay, but it says there in that scripture, that day, the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. Okay, so it was a fantastic miracle that they actually saw that day. Okay, now, you know, we're supposed to consider our ways. Now, when I started considering my way, I think I shared a bit of my testimony. You know, I'd backslidden, and I'd just met my wife, and I was kind of coming back to the Lord, and I'd already booked on a ship. I was going to see. I wanted to see the world. And now on the ship, I would say I wasn't fit for human consumption. Because after I came back from, backsliding, I was swearing, I was drinking, I was smoking. I was not a fit for human consumption. But I mean, I didn't know it at the time. But I mean, the Lord was working in my heart. On that boat for 3 months. I was only on the boat for 3 months, and luckily it came back to Cape Town so I could get off the boat. Otherwise, I would have been traveling all over for a year. But on this boat, the Lord delivered me from smoking, from drinking. I couldn't stop smoking. I tried to stop smoking about twice before. Every time I had bronchitis, I would try and stop smoking. But every time I recovered, I would smoke double, more. When the Lord delivered me from smoking, I was smoking 50 cigarettes a day, you know? And I prayed to the Lord and said, Lord, please, just take this cigarette away from me. And he took the desire away of smoking. And I was so glad about that. And of course, he delivered me from drinking. I mean, I wasn't a drunkard, but I was drinking and swearing. And the Lord sort of cleaned out my mouth as well. So by the time I got off the ship, I was actually ready to go to church. And the first thing I did was get baptized. And, you know, to me, it was like a milestone in my life, because going through the waters of baptism, it was like, you know, getting the grip of the Egyptians off me. In other words, Satan couldn't get a hold of me again. You know, I'd gone through the water. And if you read that other scripture in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1, 2, 3, whatever it is, yeah. For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers, that our forefathers were all under the cloud, and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food, you know, the manna that they ate, and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. I can remember the first rock, it mentions that he was standing on top of the rock, and Moses had to hit the rock, and then the water poured out. So it's a picture of us going through the waters of baptism and getting baptized in the Holy Spirit. And this was end of 1970, beginning 1971. Long time ago. And so later on in 1971, I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. And after that, the next year we got married. But you know, the Lord is good. He's very good. Next thing. Now the question is whether you are in Egypt still. Has Satan still got the ability to get hold of you and to drag you, you know, back into the world? Because that's what and I sort of feel, this is my personal opinion, of course. I don't know if Xavier believes this, but I believe once you've gone through the waters of baptism, Satan just hasn't got the right to try and attack you anymore. Okay? So that's just my personal opinion. We're just going to look at a couple of things. As I mentioned them, you can think of some yourself. In Egypt, it could be that you're in bondage like I was, you know, with smoking or whatever. You could be in other bondages today with the internet and all kinds of things. People get into other bondages. And so the first thing is, you know, evaluate your life. Is or has Satan got a hold on you somewhere? Have you got a bondage that you has got you? The other question is, do you believe everything that you hear, you know, on the news? Like, for instance, you know, they try to teach us about evolution and what's the other thing? Global warming, climate change. There's a whole lot of things that the world try and get you to believe, you know. There's a new thing, of course, in our schools that they're trying to teach the little kids, you know. Terrible. Okay, so you know what I'm talking about. And just one thing about climate change, you know, CO2, they're all complaining about the CO2 that's been produced in, you know, the way we live and our carbon footprint and all the rest of it. CO2, it's actually a wonderful gas. You know, all the old fridges used to run on CO2. CO2 is like R12, it's a gas that they used to use. So when it's compressed, it's a wonderful, and it's cheap, very cheap. And so when they first started with that, when I heard it the first time, I thought, no, there's something wrong with this. Because they started selling us gas, which was a cocktail of different gases, and it cost like 10 times more, you know. And so they tried to tell us that CO2 is bad. But CO2, if you've got your plants, they thrive on CO2. And the more CO2 they get, the more they thrive, and the less water they need, you know. So it doesn't make sense, okay? That's just by the way. I just wrote a couple of more things down because I thought about this. You know, if we're pampering our bodies, our physical bodies, we could be, you know, watching sports, movies, the internet. There's a whole lot of things that you can be doing which are just pampering your body. And, you know, I could pick on a couple of people here, you know. But I don't want to put you under pressure, but, you know, spending time on holidays, fishing every Sunday and work, etc., you know. But, yeah, there has to be a balance, you know, between enjoying yourself and also pampering your body, but also your spiritual side. So one needs to evaluate whether it's balanced. So that's all I'm saying. You know, it's balanced. Okay. My son-in-law, I don't know if he's going to see this on TV, but he's in New Zealand. He loves fishing, and Joe. Theon's father sent me this little thing of Angus Buckham. And he told a story about the little boy that he took fishing. And his little boy caught this lovely fish. It was on a Saturday. And when he was leaving this place, you know, that was the biggest, big fish that day, they said to him, "Are you coming back tomorrow?" He says, "No, he goes to church on Sunday." So they laughed at him. And Sunday, after they'd been to church, et cetera, they came back to the dam to get his prize for that Saturday. And what was fantastic was that nobody caught a fish on the Sunday, not one person. And his fish was the biggest fish and the only fish. So he won all the prizes, you know. So I sent that story to my son-in-law because he's always fishing instead of going to church on a Sunday. Yeah. the other thing is one can be, you know, chasing, you can be a workaholic and chase, you know, money and cars and houses and all the rest of it. I'll just tell you a bit of a testimony. When I was in Pretoria, it was 1980, 81, 82, somewhere in there. It was our third new house, okay? We'd been moved around and this was the third one and I had to do the ground, the garden, and, you know, prepare it. And we put a swimming pool in it, and it was a lovely house. It was like my favorite house, okay? And I really loved that house. And the Lord said to me, and it was so clear, he said to me, I don't want you getting attached to this house. It was sad because there was another guy across the road. He was a bank manager, and he was selling this Italian sports car. So I wanted to buy that car as well. And the Lord, he said so clearly, "I don't want you to get attached to the house or a car." And I had a BMW at that time. So in any case, I'd had it for over 10 years. Sold that and I bought this little, what was it called? Cadet. We had it for over 30 years, by the way. Yeah. It was a real faithful car. You know, when the Lord shows you something, man, it's the way to go. Okay, so I better get back to you. Okay, so I learned a couple of, you know, a couple of, what would you call them, lessons, you know, in my walk with the Lord. But, you know, in the wilderness, they should have got to know the Lord in all his names, you know. And I'm just going to mention them quickly. It's like, you know, Jehovah Roy or Elohim is Jehovah, our protector, our provider, our master, our peace, our healer, our righteousness, which is like Tzkenu or Makadesh, is our divine peace, Shema. He's also Lord of hosts, defender, encourager, nourisher, eternity. And, you know, in when you're in the desert, or in other words, when you've got out of Egypt, and you start studying the Word of God, and you go to Bible studies, and you start, you know, learning to know the Lord. You start learning all these names, and you know, I've learned so many things from Him. I could share lessons. I actually wanted to write a book once. It's on the spiritual laws of gravity. Yeah. You know, But you learn these things as you go, you know, walk the spiritual road. Okay, so we're just going to have a quick look at the beginning of their journey. Okay, so in Exodus 15, 22, 23, and 27. It says, then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went into the desert of Shur. For 3 days, they traveled into the desert without finding water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink its water because it was bitter. That is why the place is called Marah. My wife's name is Anna Marah. I love her. She's great. Anyways, they came to Elim, where there was 12 springs and 70 palm trees. And they camped there near the water. Now, when I first read that scripture, you know, when they came to Elim, 12 springs and 70 palm trees, I just saw, you know, like a picture of worship. You know, like when Jesus came into Jerusalem, they took the palm trees and they were waving them, they were worshiping them. And then there's 12 springs. When I thought about the 12 springs, I just thought about, you know, the fivefold ministries, you know, like the prophets, the apostles and the teachers and, you know, pastors. And those are the people that's kind of feed us. And, you know, they camped at this water. Now, the problem is with a lot of Christians, and I suppose some of us are like that, we like to camp there. You know, when you get to a church where the worship is nice and the ministry is nice and you don't have to do anything, you can just sit there and be entertained, a lot of us consider your way. Just think about that, because people hop, you know church hopper is. When something goes wrong in the church, the first thing they do is to go and look for another church, you know. And we need to actually become part of the church and, you know, take part in it, minister and do things that we need to do, because people depend on ministries and stuff like that. So, okay, just a thought. I'm not trying to put you, what was that word you said? Under condemnation. Yeah, don't get under condemnation. Now, while I was busy preparing this word, I know that the Lord wanted me to mention these things, because last Sunday, the music and the songs that were sung kind of, you know, spoke about these things, about God and He's in control and all this kind of stuff. And while I was busy with this, the Lord started to minister to me about something else, okay? And we're just going to go to the trumpets in Revelation. Okay? It's Revelation 8, verse 7. Now, I've read these things a couple of times, but there's only one that I was in my mind. But this, it says, the first angel sounded his trumpet. And hopefully, we'll all be raptured before this. Okay? But the first angel sounded his trumpet, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood. And it was hurled down upon the earth. And it said a third of the earth was burnt up, and a third of the trees were burnt up, and all the green grass was burnt up. Now, if you just have to look on the news and see how many fires there are all over the world, you know, it's like the Lord is warning us. It's a warning. You know, this is like the, what do they call it? Harbinger, you know? A harbinger. It's showing what's going to come. And that's why I feel that the Lord put this as a warning. I need to warn you, okay? And then the second angel sounded his trumpet, and something like a huge mountain, all ablaze, was thrown into the sea. It says a third of the sea turned into blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. The third angel sounded his trumpet, and a great star blazing like a torch fell from the sky on a third of the rivers and all the springs of the water. Next one. Oh, didn't I give you that one? Okay. It says the name of the star. He hasn't got it there. The name of the star is Wormwood. And it says a third of the water turned bitter, and many people died from the water that became bitter. Okay? So why am I telling you this? You know, the Lord has given me prophecy now and again. You know, he's given me a vision or something. You know, in 1972, just after we were married, we moved to Pretoria. And I stayed with my brother in Johannesburg for a week. I see everybody's falling asleep. It's my voice. Don't worry. So riding back from Johannesburg, I saw this. It's like a huge pipe, you know, and the petrol was sort of flowing out of it. And all of a sudden, it was cut off, like no petrol. And I shared it with my wife also, but about a year or so afterwards, we had this shortage of petrol in South Africa. I don't know if you remember it. If you were old enough, you could remember it. We couldn't buy petrol. The petrol stations closed at 6 o'clock in the evening. You couldn't ride more. I think it was more than 80 kilometers an hour, 80 miles an hour, I wasn't sure. In any case, you had to crawl. You weren't alive there. Yeah. But it was a bad time, because if you wanted to go from Cape Town or from Joburg to Cape Town, where all our family was, you had to ride. You couldn't get a can of petrol or anything like that. It was bad. Why am I telling you that? So this vision that he gave me was right, okay? And not so long ago, a couple of months ago, I had this dream, okay? And I had a computer, not a cell phone in my hand. But somebody gave me the cell phone, but some of the keys had fallen out. And they were funny shaped keys. And there were four keys that had fallen out. And I was trying to get hold of Xavier. Okay? And I was in my dream. Now I'm trying to get hold of Xavier, but people are all, speaking to him. I couldn't get close to him. I wanted to say, how do I put this thing back together again? And I couldn't, and I woke up from the dream. But later on, I shared it with Xavier, but he didn't sort of pay attention. And, you're a dreamer. So, but I asked the Lord, what does this mean? And then I saw, because I draw a picture of it, you see? And I see it's nine places for these things, okay? Then the Lord showed me, this is your family, it's nine people, okay? We were nine. Seven children, my mom and dad, there were nine of us. And four of these things that fell out, that's my mother, father, two of my brothers had died already. So it was those four things there. He showed me that's the four. But then while I was doing, another one fell out. So I shared this with Xavier. Not long after I shared this with him, his brother-in-law died in Joburg, you know. But I asked the Lord, is it me that's going to die? Or is it my other older brother? He was 85. Or my other brother who's now 78. Was it me or my sister, two sisters? And I think most of you know that in the last 6 months or eight, no, sorry, 8 weeks, both my brothers have died. Two of my brothers, only the two sisters left. And not only that, the other day, 2 weeks ago, on a Tuesday night, my daughter, who has got a friend in Malmesbury, her husband died. His name is Tom. He's 44 years old. All of a sudden, his stomach, or from his liver, stuff was running into his bake. What's it in English? Inside your stomach. What is it called? Abdomen, that's the one. So the stuff is running into his abdomen. They say it's cancer. They first said it's cancer, and then they said, no, it's not cancer. But like a week or two afterwards, we were praying for him and all this stuff, he dies. And my daughter was a bit cut up about it. It's like 2 weeks ago. And it's become very clear to me that we need to make sure, because my eldest brother was saved, you know. And I even fed him his last pudding. The night before he died, he'd got cancer, went into his spine, but he was 85, But he's saved, and we chatted till the last day that he died, you know, the day before, a day after. And he couldn't even use his hands anymore, so I fed him this pudding. But even so, he was bright, you know, when he was awake, and he spoke about the Lord, and he also warned. He said to me, it must have been close to when I was born, 1948, somewhere around there. He saw this big thing go past. He was sitting on the stoop. I still asked my other brother, did you see it? Because the two of them were apparently sitting on the stoop. And he said, no, he never saw it. Okay? Now, this is scary. Okay? Now I'm going to scare you. We just read about these things that are going to hit the earth. Okay? The last thing that I saw, vision that I saw, was a huge piece of concrete landing on top of New York. And it disappeared in the sea. Also shared with his Xavier, but I don't think Xavier sort of pays attention. Okay. Well, why are you laughing? But in any case, I was listening to a talk on the TV. There were two people. The one is Thomas Horn. He was one of the executives of the Assemblies of God in America. And he's a scientist. And then there was another guy there who had just gone on pension from NASA. And he was sharing with us about these asteroids or whatever that are coming to hit the Earth. But he said, NASA don't want the people to know about these things. You know, we've had movies of them already, okay? And this particular one, he said he's been, studying. Yeah, he's been studying. And he phoned, I think it was a librarian in Russia, okay? And she confirmed with him that this particular, because he was talking about Paphos and the other one is called Chernobyl. Now, when he, in this thing that he was doing, he discovered that Chernobyl means wormwood, okay? So, these asteroids, in other words, were saying that the one is going to hit, look, we saw three here, that came, one's not an asteroid, it was fire that came down, okay? But it could be an asteroid that gets in the air. They were saying the one is going to land in 2025. And the other, they weren't sure which is going to land where, 2027 and 2029, okay? So if that is the case, and this is going to happen at the end of the tribulation or during the tribulation, when is the rapture going to occur? It could be, you know, look, in September, October, it's the Feast of Trumpets, eh? Okay, and then with the rapture, it says the trumpet of God shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise first and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet him in the clouds. Okay, so there's a rapture coming, but it could be September, October this year, or maybe September, October next year, or even the next year. Depends on the grace of God, because everything that you look at in this world, everything is ready for the coming of the Lord. And that's why I'm warning you, because I felt that the Lord really wanted me to emphasize this. And not only that, make sure that your family, each one of your members of your family are saved. Because my other brother, he was not saved, you know. And when I confronted him, he still shook his head. And so all we could do was to pray to the Lord that that he would send the angel while he was dying, to, like, you know, just convince him or get him saved. Okay, we didn't get confirmation that he was saved. The guy next door told us one day when we got there, he said he was speaking to someone, and he couldn't speak to us. He was speaking to someone last night. So we can only trust and pray that the Lord got him saved before he died, because he was a Christian. But when my dad died, my dad died when he was 60. He prayed, and because the Lord never healed him, he said, there's no God, you know. And he was like that till he died. Okay. So make sure that your family is saved. And not only that, all you old people like me, make sure you get rid of all your rubbish. Now, why am I saying that? My brother stored up 40 years of paper and stuff. You can't believe the rubbish that he's got in that place. And then we have to clean it up. So make sure that you get rid of your rubbish so you don't leave it to your children. Okay. Sure. So all that's left is that I must make an altar call. I believe the Lord wants me to make an altar call. If there's somebody here that is still in the world, you know, is still in Egypt and hasn't gone through the waters of baptism and still suffering. I mean, there's so many. When I hear Xavier speak about the people that are without work, the people that are sick, the people that are suffering, have problems at home, you want to know why it is like that. It's because they're still in Egypt. So if there's anybody here today who wants to make a change, I sort of challenge you to, you know, put up your hand and I'll pray for you. Yeah, it doesn't look like there's anybody. They're all in the wilderness, busy learning. But in any case, the challenge is make sure that you, you know, not stuck in Egypt. Eh? Consider your ways, think about it, and just remember the time could be short, shorter than we think. Amen. Yeah. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your word. And we just pray that your word, Lord, would be the after preacher, because you've promised that your word won't return to you void. I just pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would move in each and every one of us and challenge us as to what we are about in our lives, Lord, that we must just look at our ways, Lord, and evaluate and, Lord, make the right decisions so that we won't be caught unawares. Lord, we just thank you for all your goodness and your mercy and all the wonderful things that we've experienced while walking, Lord, with you through the wilderness. Thank you, Jesus, for all the lessons you've taught us, the way that you've undertaken every single day. We give you all the praise and the glory that's due unto your name. Amen. Amen.